Commissioner Behnke, Vice Mayor Sophia, City Commissioners, County Commissioners, State Senator John Bison, State Representative Hodzma, BCU Board of Directors, and friends. Good morning and welcome to the 2019 Economic Outlook. A couple housekeeping notes. We are going to hold questions until the end, and there will be two microphones brought up to the front, so we'll please hold that to the end. This program is made possible with several sponsors, so we'd like to take a few moments and thank our sponsors for this 2019 Economic Outlook. The Battle Creek Community Foundation, Consumers Energy, Plumbers and Pipe Fitters Local 333, Semco Energy, Serial City Sunrise Rotary Club, ITC, Semco Energy, and Battle Creek Unlimited. Additionally, I'd like to thank the BCU staff for putting on the program today. Thank you. So today we're going to go over economic development activities that are occurring today and have occurred throughout this year and going forward. And we will also hear from speakers whom are experts in their respected fields on many of the topics that touch economic development and are of interest to all of us, both here in Battle Creek and Calhoun County. First of all, I will start off with the economic development activities here in Battle Creek, and then we will hear from Jim Roby from the Upjohn Institute on Battle Creek and Calhoun County trends. We will hear about education from Aurelius Diaz from the W.K. Kellogg Foundation. We will hear about hospitality from Justin Winslow. And we will hear about small business financing from Dennis West of Northern Initiatives. And finally, we'll end up with housing with Earl Pileski, the Executive Director of the State Housing Development Authority. We will do some wrap-up, Q&A, and closing remarks. So we're going to talk about the activities that Battle Creek Unlimited has operationally achieved this over this last year. In August of 2018, Battle Creek Unlimited adopted a new five-year strategic plan. This strategic plan is pretty comprehensive in the sense that it's not only talking about traditional industrial primary economic development, it talks about the comprehensive approach of community development, housing, education, and workforce. It's a very comprehensive plan that talks about how we need to move forward and grow our community to create a vibrant community to help us attract folks in these industry sectors. So we've got automotive OEM supply chain, aviation defense, food and beverage, logistics services, and we added a new sector this year, energy storage. Now some of you might think that, yeah, these are pretty standard sectors to Battle Creek, but I gotta tell you folks, the automotive industry is changing exponentially. Aviation and defense is changing with the advent and the acceleration of technology. The food and beverage industry is constantly changing, and logistics is constantly changing with the last mile and the Amazon effect, and energy storage as well. So all of these together, Battle Creek is well positioned to take advantage of these because we have a lot of the DNA that supports not only the traditional side of this, but the future side of what these sectors will bring. And I want to really talk about aviation and defense and logistics. It's not called out specifically, but between those two sectors, we talk about drones and the acceleration of drone activity in the United States and the world, and we're going to look to take advantage of it. Energy storage, we are very fortunate to have a lot of the pieces that support energy storage here in Battle Creek with our automotive OEM supply chain and the advent of the electric vehicle and the progression of the electric vehicles. They are here, they are coming, and we believe that we're well positioned to take advantage of the supply chain right here in Battle Creek. In fact, we have a company in the fort, BASF Toda, which makes a cathode material for lithium ion batteries, and it's an exciting time for that industry. Battle Creek Unlimited in October received a grant from the MEDC for $150,000. This grant was twofold. It was to focus on missile defense and also to understand and to take advantage of the drone market. So $50,000 of this was to really understand the economic benefits beyond just us being decided as a missile defense site here in Battle Creek. What other economic activities or things can come along with that? What happened at Fort Greely, Alaska, and what happened at Vandenberg Air Force Base in California? So we're really analyzing that. So if and when the call comes, we can take full advantage of that selection. Additionally, $100,000 of that is being utilized currently. It started in December to position Battle Creek and to understand how Battle Creek can take advantage of drone activity. We've engaged some consultants who have experience in setting up a drone research and development park in North Dakota. So what they are doing right now is they're analyzing the assets of Battle Creek and specifically the W.K. Kellogg Airport to understand how do manned airplanes and unmanned airplanes all work together. This talks about the airspace, how it's divided, the radar systems which help them talk amongst each other. So they're putting all of these things together and putting a cost associated with it as well so that we can start to position ourselves to take advantage of this up and coming industry. And additionally, in October, Battle Creek Unlimited unveiled a new office and is part of a full facelift of the Custom Cargo Center. This Custom Cargo Center has been integral and is so important to the economic development activity here in Battle Creek for the last 40 years. That facility has incubated dozens of companies which now call Fort Custer home, and it has also incubated Denso, which is now Battle Creek's largest employer. So we're very fortunate to have that facility, and we're reprogramming it for the next 40 years. Also, when you all came in this morning and started eating, you may have saw some promotional videos playing. They'll play again at the end. But this is really a talent attraction play. Battle Creek Unlimited worked on developing some talent attraction videos, and we're utilizing these to push these out on social media into other markets and really let people know the economic opportunities that are available here in Battle Creek. It's been successful. It's got a lot of looks, and we're going to continue this. We're just getting started on that. Now we're going to talk about the new and existing business expansions, as well as some things that have been in the works and the status of them, and some things that are coming down the pipe as well. So we talked a little bit about this last year, but Prairie Farms invested $29 million starting in January of 2018 and added 16 new jobs. Also, we added the Dennis Group to downtown Battle Creek. 65 new jobs, $600,000 investment. The Dennis Group is a food engineering group located out of Springfield, Massachusetts. And they work with a lot of global food companies, both on their production, mostly within their production side. They help design plants, modernize plants, redesign plants. But they work with these global food companies, and they decided to set up their first operation here in Battle Creek, Michigan. We beat out Indiana and Illinois for this operation, so we're very excited with what the Dennis Group is going to bring to Battle Creek. These are high-paying engineering jobs. Also, in November of this last year, Waco, a company that we have here in Battle Creek, was bought out by a German aerospace group, Demor Aero. And I mention that because Waco makes a biplane at the W.K. Kellogg Airport. And I can tell you, Demor Aerospace has some very aggressive expansion plans here for Battle Creek. They're looking to invest nearly $12 to $15 million just to start out, and they're looking to add about 60,000 square feet. And they've got some pretty aggressive and some pretty creative ideas that we're working with the city of Battle Creek, the W.K. Kellogg Airport folks, and we'll be excited to share those creative plans that they're looking to do out there when we can. But just to give you kind of an idea of the scope and the magnitude of what they're looking to do, if you look to the left of the screen there, the areas in yellow and blue are all the new expansion areas. So they're more than doubling their footprint. And this project should get underway this summer. Also, just this year, January 7th, Torishima Pump announced a $1.5 million investment and 11 new jobs in the Fort Custer Industrial Park. They're occupying a significant portion of the former Clyde Union Pump facility, and this brings our Japanese company count up to 19 in Battle Creek. Also, we've heard about this one over the years, but we're set to break ground. Western Michigan University is set to break ground on their College of Aviation this year. This is approximately a $24 million project, and this is going to expand their educational offerings and opportunities here in Battle Creek. It's going to double their space. They're going to be able to support hundreds of more students. And if you get a chance, if you hadn't already when you came in, check out, there's some more renderings up to the front of the room, but we've got a few renderings here for you today in the slides. This is just exciting, and it's going to be a huge opportunity for Battle Creek, so we need to wrap our hands around. This is an asset that we have that most communities don't have. There'll be hundreds of additional students transitioning through our community. Okay, we're going to talk about some community development projects as well. We really hit our stride this year when we started talking about community development projects. There's over $47 million worth of business investment in the works on community development with 60 new jobs. And I guess probably one of the most exciting ones is New Holland Brewing. So this time last year, in December of 17, Battle Creek Unlimited released an RFP to allure a brewery to Battle Creek, and we associated that with a $200,000 incentive package. We got a lot of activity on that, and on April 20th, we were lucky to announce that Michigan's third largest brewer, New Holland Brewing, was going to set up shop, their third shop, in Battle Creek, Michigan. This is nearly a $3.85 million investment with 50 jobs. And I can tell you folks that New Holland is excited to get here. We're all excited to have New Holland here. There's been a lot in the works, and if you'd really just take a step back and think, boy, from end of April to May, they decided to come to Battle Creek. We've done a lot of things behind the scenes. They had to have architectural renderings, engineered plans. There's just been a whole heck of a lot of activity behind the scenes going on. And within an 8-9 month period, we're getting close to seeing that launch. So I know it can't come fast enough, but when they do come, we as a community, we need to rally behind them and show them that they made the right choice to locate here in Battle Creek. Also, during that same process, we decided not only to award one brewery, we decided to award two breweries. We have a mystery startup brewer that is going to be locating in 15 Carlisle. We awarded the proposal to Restore 269 that has a pretty neat mixed-use development underway or in the works. It's a three-story building, brewery in the basement, office space on the second floor, and event space on the third floor. So, and I'm happy to announce that as of last Thursday, their federal historic tax credits were awarded by the federal government, and that was the last piece of the capital stack, and you should see some activity here in March. So we will see some activity, yes. Also kind of want to quickly talk about the loan fund. I won't go too far into that. There's some folks that are going to talk about this a little later in our presentation, but we're very thankful for our partnership with the W.K. Kellogg Foundation for announcing this $10 million loan fund, and I'm proud to say that Battle Creek Unlimited has committed to contributing $1.2 million to this fund. And on November 28th, a project we have all talked about and all heard about for years upon years, the final piece of the puzzle was put in place. On November 28th, there was a huge group from Battle Creek that went up to the MEDC offices for the Strategic Fund Board meeting, and we were awarded a $10 million package, which was the last piece of the financial capital stack to get Heritage Tower going. So we're very excited about that $32 million project. You can see the activities going on right now, and this is a key catalyst project for the turnaround of downtown. These are some current images of the inside of Heritage Tower right now, the restoration that is taking place. We're very excited that we had a tour yesterday, and work is well underway. Also, I would be remiss if I did not talk about the good work that the Small Business Development Fund is doing between John, Valerie, Ted, and the city. This last year, they launched BC Cargo, which they incubated 7 companies, including Cafe Rica. This was their first go of it last year, and they're looking forward to their 2019 season, which will get underway on May 1st. So if you want some more information on that, please contact John, Valerie, Ted. And if you need their contact information, you can always contact Battle Creek Unlimited, and we'll get you in touch with them. As part of their BC Cargo project, they took the next phase. This recently just started was Kitchen, which is a retail food service incubator located at 80 West Michigan. And this is really graduating from starting a business at the BC Cargo into a storefront. And we've got 2 businesses there right now, Cafe Rica and Simply Sensational. So, you can see the progression here. This is exciting stuff, and John and Valerie have done a great job on that. Also, some of their work includes Marketing Mondays and Sisters in Business. These are very great events. They've had 8 events in 2018, and they've 7 women participated in a pitch event, awarded $3,500 in prize, and a BC Cargo unit. So let's talk a little bit about some of the community development projects that are in the works. With Heritage Tower coming online, New Holland moving to town, 80 West Michigan going, 15 Carlisle going, and some other great things that are all coming online, we thought it appropriate to double down on our RFP process. So in December, we announced the same kind of incentive RFP for dining and restaurant options in Battle Creek to time so that we can get some more restaurant and dining options in downtown, so when folks come to Battle Creek, they have multiple options to choose from. So this project, this RFP is currently underway and is in the works at this moment. We're excited to see what kind of proposals come through, and the deadline on this is March 22nd. So this is all about timing. We're timing it. Everything has to come in a timed fashion. You talk about the chicken or the egg. We need the chicken and the egg at the same time. So this is really the approach that we're taking. We're also working on the redevelopment of the Shranks property. We acquired this. We are going to market it for redevelopment. And this building has some safety issues with it. There's a wall that is separating, so we're looking forward to getting that taken care of in redevelopment hands. Just want to take a moment really to pause. We talked about, I really went through a lot of stuff here going on in downtown, and I can tell you there's much more in the works right now going on behind the scenes. But when you really put numbers to it, it's like, wow, there's a lot of things going on. Right now, currently, there is 330,000 square feet of square footage of space under construction or soon to be under construction in downtown Battle Creek, and there's an additional 40,000 square feet being contemplated in the works. So that's huge. Also, we'd like to kind of transition back out to the fort and our defense community. We'd like to talk about the 34 new jobs that the Air National Guard, they've stood up a new mission that was announced in December this last year. For folks that are familiar with the A-10s and when the A-10s left, the Air National Guard kind of was trying to find its way. Well, I can tell you the Air Guard has found its way under great leadership out at the Air National Guard. We have modern new missions in cybersecurity, the MQ-9s, and they are in good standing with the Guard Bureau in DC. So I attribute that to the great leadership out at the Air Guard base. Also, missile defense. Everybody always asks about missile defense. We had an announcement this January. The missile defense review was released, and really it was, I guess I would say, somewhat underwhelming, but the report talked about expanding the current capacity in Fort Greely, Alaska. If and when there is a new site that needs to be built, they would look towards the environmental impact studies that have already been submitted to the Department of Defense, which includes Battle Creek. Bottom line, the DOD did not name a preferred site. that was directed by Congress. So we will need to rally our Michigan CODEL to push for Fort Custer to be designated the third site. Also, workforce support. About $1 million of investment, 2 new jobs, 6 part-time jobs. If you didn't get an opportunity today, before you leave, go over and check out the van in the corner of Equitas. Equitas, I got to give a shout out to Scott Cubberly. Scott has been working on this for well over a year, probably 2 years. He stuck with it, and now we have a pretty dynamic on-demand transportation model up and running in Battle Creek. We're still in the soft phases of it, but basically this gets workers from point A to point B in a more efficient on-demand model. And it helps our employers. The employers can participate, the employees can participate, they can do a combination of both, but we're really looking to grow this. Right now they have 2 vans running, and they have the possibility of getting up to multiple vans beyond that. So if you get an opportunity, please go talk to Scott, see how your company can participate in this program, and go check out the van. Additionally, I'd like to give a shout out to our friends at Michigan Works. They did a great job this last year of securing over $750,000 for 11 of our local companies in Going Pro Michigan Talent Funds. This was huge. This is going to help continue to develop our workforce. That's all I have for economic development, and I'm going to turn it over to Jim Roby.
Good morning. Thanks for staying in your seats long enough to listen to this. I'm Jim Roby with the Upjohn Institute. Many of you know my predecessor well, George Eriksen. And George always started with, and good friend, with a joke. But in the essence of time and wanting to give you good data, Joe and I agreed that we would have no humor in this presentation. So no jokes this morning. I'm with the Upjohn Institute. Many of you know the organization. We are a think tank in Kalamazoo. I'm one of 13 PhDs on staff. But also, Joe just mentioned Michigan Works. Half of our team provides Michigan Works services in 4 counties, including Calhoun County. And I want to give them a shout out. I know they're here today. From PTAC to the Ruck folks, Jackie, Ben, Cheryl, Ashley, and others I'm probably not mentioning. But let's get to the data. I think that's what you're really interested in. So as we look, and this is not an expansion graph, this is a peak-to-peak graph. And so as you look at this, we are in the very last one that will show up here. In the longest peak-to-peak period for recessions, for coming out of recessions through that cycle. And why is this important? It's important because people make investments and other things around recessions. And one thing Joe asked me to talk about was, what's the likelihood of a recession coming? And really, in working with our friends at University of Michigan, talking to other economists around the country, there is no recession on the horizon. It is, if anything, 24 to 36 months out. So as we look at this expansion, we should expect to see it continue, and I'll give you a little bit more evidence as we move on. If you look at these, as the prior slide said, we are in the second longest expansion, and part of the reason for that was the amount of time that we spent in this recovery or through this cycle in the contraction phase, which was 18 months prior compared to the prior recession of 8 months. We are 128 months into the recovery, 128 months total in the cycle compared to 134, but we're a little bit short. We're 4 months short in the actual expansion, but again, there is nothing that suggests that we won't exceed that record and continue on with it. One thing I'd like to do is just for a moment, and this is an argument that we have within our folks at One thing that I want to do is get people to think about decoupling the markets. And so if you look at this market graph from early 2018 through, you'll see all kinds of cycles. You'll see the TPP we pulled out of it. You'll see solar tariffs. You'll see China tariffs. You'll see retribution tariffs. You'll see all kinds of things. You'll see a government shutdown. And what you see is a lot of market volatility. But the reality is that the fundamentals of the economy have not changed in that period. Unemployment is low. Labor force participation is up. We have seen some slowing in GDP. There are some estimates that Q4 GDP and maybe Q1 GDP for this year have gotten back to about 2%. But let me say that 2% growth is not a recession. It's kind of returning back to a trend basis. So really, it's important to decouple what's going on in the Dow and the markets from what's going on fundamentally within the economy. The markets tend to react to day-to-day events, prices, earnings per share, profits reported, met, not met, all those sorts of things. But the fundamentals of the market are incredibly solid. When we look at GDP growth, we saw some above 4% growth, but if we really look over time, the real trend since World War II has been about 2% average real growth, so that's growth without inflation in it. What we've seen in the last year or so has been some much stronger numbers, but the forecast from the Survey of Professional Forecasters, which is the light blue ones that I just put up, the Survey of Forecasters are a collection, a panel survey that's done by the Philadelphia Fed regularly with about 39 or 40 people and groups of economists contributing to it. Their real numbers are about 2.5%. So a little bit better growth than we've seen over trend, but really moving back to that trend. But certainly, again, if we look out over the next 5-6 quarters, no one's expecting any sort of a recession. Where we haven't seen the growth, and we really wonder where the opportunity is to get that growth, is in the employment sector. As we look at Calhoun County, and we'll talk about that, the state of Michigan and the nation, we have relatively decent labor force participation, relatively low unemployment rates, and so where are we going to get some of those folks to come into the markets? Our good friends, and all you Spartan fans, I apologize. Our good friends at University of Michigan have a tremendous forecasting unit. We rely on them a great deal. You'll see the numbers in red. This is their forecast for early January that they provide to the state treasurer for the revenue for the state. This is their change from their forecast from fall 2018. What they saw was a slight decrease of about 0.1% in GDP growth for this year, still at 2.6%, well above trend. And the forecast for next year, 2020, a little bit below trend at 1.7%. A lot of people think that we're getting past that hangover of the tax incentives and other things. I'm not as convinced about that, and I think there are a lot of economists who are mixed on that. On the employment, we expect to see employment growth about 1.5% this year, 2% next year, unemployment rate being at 3.5% to 3.4% over the next 2 years. Why is that important? The natural rate of unemployment, it's the closest thing the Fed says to full employment, is about 4.6% and moving downward. It's kind of a moving target, so there isn't a real solid number, but the reality is that the national economy, probably the state economy, and Calhoun County are all at full employment, which makes it hard to find people to come to work. Housing starts at 1.3 million for this year and next year, because the problem we're seeing, and we see it in West Michigan, we see it in Calhoun County, is the cost of new housing is $175 to $250 a square foot. You can't find tradespeople, and so that continues to be a problem. And inflation, which used to be an issue, the target for the feds to raise the basis points on the Fed funds rate was around 2%, along with some other things, as you've been maybe following this, although the Fed put out mixed messages yesterday on this, whether we'll see some rate increases this year, very mixed messages. Certainly the president doesn't want that to happen, businesses don't want that to happen, but that 2% was an important thing there. In looking at that probability of recession, this is the Moody's prediction of recession, the percent probability of a recession in the next six months. What we saw was it in the end of 2018, as low as 10%. It is moving up, trending up to about 17%, but still 1 in 5 probability is pretty low that we'll see anything happening. Again, the fundamentals of the economy are in place. Interest rates have been moving up. We've all been feeling that. You see a little bit increase in housing rates going up and down depending on the term of the mortgage. Auto loan rates are going up. Cost of businesses are going up. But also at the same time, as I mentioned earlier, inflation is going up. And with that, inflation moving along with the cost of interest, really once you subtract inflation from there, the real cost of capital is pretty close to zero in many cases. And so once you adjust, it makes some sense to continue to invest, to see productivity, because the cost of capital remains historically low. And we'll see how Dennis thinks about that. I'll be curious. So thinking about Battle Creek, when we look at employment in the MSA, we continue to see employment across all sectors at above pre-recession levels, and that happened sort of 2014, 2015. Manufacturing continues to be, you know, an amazing standout here. Joe and the team do a great job, and as well as, you know, their partners at the county and the city in doing manufacturing, and though there's a lot of investment. One of the great rate-limiting factors is you've got relatively flat population, and with that, it's hard to generate lots of new jobs. And then, of course, we know the struggles with housing across the country is where do we put people who want jobs? Services has been a little bit different than manufacturing in the county. It's been lagging a little bit, and we've not seen that growth, but with some of the investment that Joe talked about in those amenities, those service types of jobs, from professional and scientific and technical jobs all the way into the population serving things, certainly will be there as a larger portfolio of amenities can be incorporated. The unemployment rate, not seasonally adjusted for Calhoun County in December, the most recent data, is at 4.1, well below the national rate for full employment. The national rate in December was 3.7, but remember that full employment rate is 4.5 or 4.6%, and so it really is a pretty tight labor market here, and most employers here know that, whether you're from the city, the county, the private sector, everybody is hiring. I was driving through up to Cadillac the other day and passed a Grand Rapids police car, and on the back was a bumper sticker that said, "We're hiring." Not what I expected to see. Labor force participation rate in December in the county was about 59%, and one thing we're talking with Joe about is trying to disaggregate that, and we were talking with Senator Bison about that. What are the components that affect that decision? How much of that is just simply the organics of young people and geezers like me that may not be in the workforce anymore? The national rate is 62.8 to 63.1. It varies quite a bit. To get to that rate, we'd have to bring another 4,000 people into the labor market. And Joe kind of asked me, he said, well, what's going on with minority unemployment, minority labor force participation? And so in this case, getting local data on this is very difficult. So minority is essentially non-white, which includes African Americans, Hispanics, Asians, Native Americans, and others. And so kind of give you the relative statistics, total labor force participation rate in 2007, so pre-recession, was at 59.8%, white was at 61.1%, and minority was at 52%, so only about half the population was participating. Relatively speaking, in Calhoun County, minority unemployment in 2007 was 12%, and unemployment for the entire population was at 7.7%. What's that look like today? And the most recent data from the feds is for 2017. We see that nearly every group, everybody, whites and minorities, are about 59% participation rates. So we've really seen a lot of people, kind of the rising tide as the economy's gotten good again, we see a lot of people participating. Unemployment rates for whites were 6.7% in 2017. but 15% for minorities. So it's gone up from 12 to 15%. Is that a good thing or a bad thing? I think it's a bit of both. One, it's unfortunate to see it rise, but what it says is that other people have entered the job market, because keep in mind that the unemployment rate is that part of labor force participation, that 59.4% that are participating, that are looking for jobs but don't have them. So it suggests that people are participating in the markets because economic opportunity is better than it was. So, one of the things that we've been looking at, and we have some neat new data called Infuter data. It takes census data and looks where people move back and forth. And so what we see is, where have Calhoun County residents gone? And we see that probably with retirements and buyouts and other things, that we're seeing people heading to warmer places. But we see a lot of movement along the industrial corridor on I-94 between Kalamazoo and Detroit, and this is the kind of county to county movement. So these are, where are people gone? This is, where are people coming from? And so we see still people coming back from places like Atlanta and Dallas and Houston and New York, but we see a lot of intra-regional movement along that I-94 corridor. And we're working with Joe and the team to start to think about what this means. But maybe the more interesting one is that everybody is always concerned about brain drain. And so this is from 2008 to 2018. What we really see is that our brain drain is within that industrial corridor and business corridor from Kalamazoo over to Detroit, where we're not seeing that huge shift of people to warmer places and other places that we might expect. What we're seeing is people moving out along the I-94 corridor. Where are people coming from? Very similarly, people are going out and coming back. And why are we focusing on this 25 to 34? At this point, these are the young workers that have skills that we're looking for, that are probably knowledge economy workers. And so it really is, they're not coming back from lots of other places, so the boomerangs, the salmons, and others at this point in that period, but it really is a lot of movement within southern Michigan. So the population trends over the last few years have been sort of net negative. When we look at the last 5 years, those first slides were for the last 10 years. We see in movement of about 11,000 people overall, out movement of about 15,000. But again, that may be a demographic shift, not a worker shift. Aged 25 to 34, we've seen 844 move in, 1,280 move out, for a negative 436. And I know Joe and his team are starting to address those sorts of issues. And then in that kind of second prime age working group, we see 1,200 out, 1,800 in. So again, as opportunity presents itself, some of that may change. So one thing that Joe mentioned earlier was this interest in Battery City. And so we have a model at the Institute called the REMI model. It's regional economic models. And so we use that to estimate economic impacts. And so Joe said, what's the impact if we get 100 jobs in primary battery manufacturing in Calhoun County? And these outline the numbers. So that 151 total jobs include those 100 manufacturing jobs at the plant. So another 51 jobs, so about a 1.5 multiplier. For every job we bring in, you get another half job. 144 in the private sector, so the other seven are made up in city and county types of operations. Output, that's essentially sales, about $29 million for each 100 workers. Value added, that's the important thing that creates wealth. That's the thing that labor contributes outside of parts, about $15 million. And income, about $8 million. Now, let me just clarify a couple things here. One, this is the direct jobs, this is the supply chain jobs, this is all the amenity jobs that Joe talked about in breweries and restaurants and all those things that go downtown. But let me say, this is also an underestimate. If you think now, what's the infrastructure for some suppliers and others for batteries in the region? As Joe and his team attract other suppliers to this, that number will only grow. So this, if anything, is a very conservative estimate of what 100 jobs in battery manufacturing mean to the region. So how do we do? It's always important. So our current estimate was, we expected about 1% growth, and we're not good there. You know, at this point, you know, we're economists, and I was just invited to speak somewhere on April Fool's Day, and I thought, boy, that's great, invite an economist to give a forecast on April Fool's Day. So our forecast was 1.5% for goods producing, that's construction and manufacturing. In reality, you did much better at 2.7% growth. Service providing, we thought you'd do better, and as the numbers showed, it's lagged a little bit. We weren't good there. And government, we expected a small decline, and you had a bigger decline. I'll leave that to you because I'm from a nonpartisan organization to determine whether that's a good thing or not. So what's our forecast for 2019 and 2020? We projected 1% or a tenth of a percent growth. We're projecting about 0.8% growth. I mean, much of what you've seen here will help with that. And then we're looking at some negative growth, and I love that economics term, negative growth for next year. In the goods producing sector, we predicted strong results. We're looking really again at strong results. The real question we're having is, where are workers coming from? And so we look at a little bit of a downturn. This is somewhat consistent with our friends at RSQE. Again, within goods producing, within service producing, and I'll try not to do that again, we tend to see some negative growth there. And then in government, negative growth last year, a little bit of growth this year, and then some negative growth the year after. So overall, how this kind of settles out, we expect sort of slower growth for Battle Creek than say the state or the nation. In goods producing, we expect you to do better than the state. Service producing, less well. And then within government, we'll see what happens. So I'd like to thank all the folks on my team that I get to come here, be in front of you, eat breakfast. They get to go back to work and do more of this. So thanks so much for your time this morning.
Good morning. Buenos dias. Is there any Latinos out there? Oh, yay. See a few. Well, geez, a little bad news there. But let me share some good news. Yesterday, I had some guests. I'm Aurelis Diaz, by the way, Kellogg Foundation. And I had some guests out from Seattle and from Minneapolis. And we had dinner at Kitchen Proper. And they said that that was the best meal they had had ever. So that's fantastic news for our Battle Creek work, right, and economic. We have some really cool things happening, even though the forecast doesn't. It feels like the forecast of the polar vortex, right? But things are going to turn around for us for sure. Well, I'm excited to share some really good news on what we've been up to, and I appreciate the invitation to present to you all here. At the W.K. Kellogg Foundation, as you, many of you know, we are a private philanthropic organization, and we take pride. Many of the folks that come to work at the foundation are very deeply connected to our strategies and our approaches, and I'll talk to you a little bit about that. But Mr. Will Keith Kellogg, who is our dear founder, we're still very connected, even though he left very strict instructions for no family members to be involved at any level of the organization. We are very committed to his first 11 years, the writings that he shared with us and left for us, and we follow that guidance still today. And so we're close to celebrating our 100 years here, and so we're preparing for 2030 and what that will mean for us. But one of the things that we do is we read a lot of his writings. So when the board, for example, meets for their retreats on a yearly basis, they start the retreats reading the letter that he wrote to them. And one of the quotes that we use often is, use the money as you please, so long as it promotes the health, happiness, and well-being of children. We're still very committed to that. And that looks very similar still today. This is a great picture of our work in Haiti and the education work that we do there with Beautiful Faces, promoting his quote there. We're still very much dedicated to children and knowing that children are part of families and those families are part of community. And so that affinity model for us is about trying to promote children that thrive in working families and then in equitable communities. How it works for us, and I'll give you some examples with thriving children. We're very committed to early childhood. We know that all areas of a child's life matter, but we've decided and determined based on his writings and commitment, we are focusing on the earliest years. So birth through age 8 is our sweet spot. And so early childhood development and education is where we dedicate a lot of funds. An example in brain development, school success, and community engagement. So we partner with individuals like Dr. Dana Susskind from Chicago. Who was a cochlear implant surgeon and realized, for example, that there was an enormous gap between children of color and their counterparts and when they received their cochlear implants and the progress that they were making. And she did much research and calculated, I don't know if you've all heard, the 30 million word gap between specific groups of children and realized that that gap could be closed with specific opportunities. And so we funded her work to be able to do the research, but also develop strategies for families. And she's developed that in a variety of languages to close the gap, the 30 million word gap. And we have funded, when it comes to community engagement, things, as you know, as the BC Vision work here in the community surveys. In Mississippi, there was a very similar effort called Better Together, and we funded that work as well. And we work on pay equity for early childhood teachers, and there's a stark difference between early childhood teachers and what they are paid nationwide and their counterparts in K-12. And so we try to really do advocacy work around that. And with working families, we really think about what does that mean for building the pipeline of the workforce. Example that I would share is in Albuquerque, New Mexico. We partnered with a local group that was really frustrated. Albuquerque was growing and the construction industry was also growing. And they did not have a workforce to be able to manage everything that it takes in the construction business. So we partnered with local groups there and built ACE High School. And what ACE High School does, all the curriculum was co-designed with the construction community. And so there's apprenticeship right through high school. There's opportunities to learn specific trades as they're in high school. And as they graduate from high school, they're absolutely ready to join that workforce. And so that's an example of a partnership. With equitable communities, we are really looking at affordable child care. In Detroit, we partnered with some other groups there and have formed Hope Starts Here, which is really tackling affordable child care, and then small business enterprises as well. I would give an example. In Haiti, we've done some really incredible things with small business enterprise there. There's peanut farmers. The peanuts in Haiti are really unique, and they are also produce incredible peanut butter. And they really had to learn how to manage drying the peanuts and they also needed some support in the business structure of how to sell the peanuts and market the peanuts appropriately. So we've partnered with them and they've made tremendous gains there. And we've partnered with moms there to help them with raising chickens and then selling the chickens and being able to provide for their families, being able to provide education for their children, and to be able to create a sustainability and opportunity for them to support their families, and it's been remarkable. So those are some examples of how we partner and how it works for us, of thriving children, working families, and equitable communities. And then we'll take a look at what it looks like here in Battle Creek. So particularly for education, we looked at Battle Creek Public Schools as an enormous investment, and it was an important investment. If you remember, that really stemmed from the New York study that was commissioned by the BC Vision cohort of individuals, and that revealed some pretty significant inequalities, salvage inequalities in the community between children in Battle Creek Public Schools and those in others. And so it also revealed some segregation and some opportunities for us as a foundation. And so because of that New York study, we, and also the strategic plan that Superintendent Kim Carter had designed, we decided to make a historical investment. It's the largest investment we have made as an institution of $51 million to support the closing of that gap. And I'll share a little bit more about that strategic plan and why we invested there. And then we've also thought more broadly and comprehensively how we support those efforts. And so one of the pieces that have been really challenging for the district is recruiting and retaining teachers. And so the teacher housing incentive is an opportunity for us to recruit and retain teachers. It can be utilized for new teachers and purchasing homes, but it could also be used for existing teachers with remodeling efforts, and that has been very well received. There's about a dozen teachers that have utilized that, and more have applied. And then we're excited about, of course, the Battle Creek Small Business Loan Fund that I'll talk a little bit more about as well. And so this was the plan that Superintendent Kim Carter presented to us that felt absolutely in line with the opportunity to support the district in a way that would be respectful and would also address the needs of the district that were realized during the New York study reading and research. So Superintendent Kim, even prior to that, had developed some 6 goals to greatness. And in education, my former life before coming to the foundation, I worked for a school district in right outside of Grand Rapids and did some transformation work. So worked as a teacher, a principal, and assistant superintendent. And there was definitely her goals to greatness were supported also by research and best practices. And so we were very intrigued by what she had laid out. It was a very specific plan in how she felt that the district could be turned around. And it also mirrored and reflected the needs that the New York study had revealed to us. So definitely high academic achievement. And the new the evaluation already for the first year shows significant improvements and definitely a pathway for improvement. A healthy organizational culture, and in doing specifically some transformation work, that is essential in any school district, is really to transform the culture, the how teachers view students, how the district engages parents, how students believe in themselves, and that's all signifies the culture, not just for the educators, but everyone that is part of that culture. And then the human capital strategy, as referred to, recruiting and retaining teachers was a significant challenge, and so we have thought about a variety of ways to support that as well. And partnering with universities is a way that we are looking forward to expanding that opportunity. And then the efficient and effective use of resources. She had very strategic planning around what she needed to cut and what she needed to grow to be able to ensure that the transformation would happen and we supported that as well with communications and marketing opportunities. And you've seen, I'm sure, all of some of those probably around Believe in the Change. And the active partnerships with our community, you know, our state Department of Education and State Superintendent have come to Battle Creek and have utilized Battle Creek Public Schools as an example of the incredible partnerships. And that's very much contributed to many of you in the room. So thank you for the partnerships that you have established and continue to. And the world-class infrastructure, this Battle Creek Central High School is just it's a beautiful building. And we know that the infrastructure of a district matters. And she had specific plans for how to improve some schools that needed improvement and how to maintain some schools. So seeing and experiencing her plan along with the New York study and the best practices that we see nationwide and what works for our schools was really the catalyst for us investing and making such a huge investment in Battle Creek Public Schools as the study revealed and as our commitment to this community as well. And then we have focused a lot on the Small Business Loan Fund. We launched this in 2018. There was a lot of excitement internally at the foundation to be able to utilize our investment team internally that has not really previously been involved with programmatic opportunities. Many foundations have their investment teams even stationed in New York City, for example. Ours is right, our whole team is right here in Battle Creek, and they typically only focus on investing. There is a clear separation typically in most foundations between our investment team and our programmatic team. And this was a space that our investment team really joined the table in full force and very excited to be able to bring ideas and suggestions, recommendations, and roll up their sleeves and be able to help us do part of this work. And so we were excited to contribute with other local investors. As you know, Battle Creek Unlimited, as Joe mentioned previously, the Miller Foundation, the Kellogg Company, Consumers Energy Foundation, and we hope others, because right now it has grown to $6.6 million, but we really would like this to grow to $10 million. And we have so far made 8 loans that we're excited about, and we want to grow this into more, because those loans mean new businesses, and new business means some more prosperity for Battle Creek. We're excited to be able to be a part of that, because for us, our strategies of health and education and economic equity for children and families in this community are directly connected to our approaches, our DNA as a foundation, which is very much grounded around leadership, community engagement, and racial equity. And without the combination of the two, we wouldn't be able to create the conditions that we so desire for communities to grow and to thrive. And so I welcome any questions that you may have around what I've presented a little later. Thank you for your time.
Good morning. I think we're about halfway there now. Well, I want to thank the BCU team for this opportunity. They've been fantastic to work with, whether it's Joe, Robert, Bridget, or Paula. Fantastic team here in Battle Creek, and I appreciate the opportunity. I'll talk briefly. This is our new logo. We are just completing a merger of the Statewide Lodging Association into our association to be sort of a united restaurant and lodging association. If you're in the industry, you probably get it. It's a pineapple. It's the international symbol of hospitality. If you're not, I've gotten a lot of questions of, you know, we don't grow pineapples in Michigan. What is that? Why are you doing that? It makes no sense to me. So I'm on an education tour, so anyone not in our industry will hopefully understand why it is that we have a non-native fruit as the new symbol of the association. I'd also be remiss if I didn't give a shout out to Hans and Sue and all the team here at Schuler's. We are a 100-year-old association, or just shy of that, and that family and that organization has been part of this association from the very beginning across multiple generations. So thank you to that, and thank you for being here. It's good to see you. Okay, how big are we? We are the second largest employer as a private employer in the state of Michigan when you combine restaurants and lodging together. Pretty sizable, nearly 18,000 independent locations, over $40 billion in gross sales, representing about 10% of the state's entire GDP. The employment is massive as well. Over 600,000 employees work in this industry. Both of these industries are particularly labor intensive, and that represents approximately 12.5%, I'm going to back off a little bit, of the total workforce in the state. So sizable industry overall. So trends to watch in 2019. The restaurant industry is going to continue to grow. If I had been here a year ago, I might have suggested that we had some concerns on the horizon. The restaurant industry has always been a harbinger of what's going to happen with the overall economy. You see some negative signs happen in this industry first before you see it happen in the broader economy. And there were some concerning signs last year, even though there was some slow growth. But we'll get to why that is in a minute. But 2018 was a more solid year than 2017 was, and I realize I'm going to have to click these individually, but you're going to see 4% growth is anticipated in the industry overall, and that is wide-ranging from large growth in the fast casual sector, that is your Paneras of the world, your Chipotles of the world, and very slow growth when you consider the family dining of the world, that is your, think of a diner without a liquor license, frankly. That is a sector that is continuing to struggle in this economy. It's growing, but not much past the rate of inflation right now. Traffic and transaction counts have been more flat. We'll get to that a little bit as well, because this is an industry that is in a transformational stage right now. Restaurant industry has been slow to adapt to technology, but technology is here and impacting the industry tremendously, and there's a lot of disruption going on. It's part of why you see some wide-ranging patterns in growth. We do our own independent study at the association about across all of our members, and we do these things quarterly, and we have some good news to report, frankly, as growth is anticipated to be just shy of 4% itself in Michigan, so pairing pretty closely to what the national trend looks like for the restaurant industry. Operators are continually bullish. 3.1% is the kind of growth we saw in 2018, so the fact that they are seeing and anticipating 3.8% this coming year is a good sign. That's a good sign, because these numbers were not as optimistic a year ago. So feeling a better place in going into 2019 than we were going into 2018. You can expect menu prices to increase by about 2% as well, per the survey put out just very recently by the association. Okay, what are some of the other challenges? Workforce and uncertain wage climate. Hands down, and I know you probably hear this across most industries. This industry, because it is so labor intensive, feels the challenges of a workforce shortage. We just did a seminar with members in Detroit yesterday presenting on opportunities to retain employees better, to recruit what you need better, but it continues to be the single biggest challenge. And I say that in a year where we saw a threats to the minimum wage, threats on more mandated benefits to be provided that challenge this industry a little more acutely than it challenges others. Those concerns still secondary to the ability to just recruit and retain enough employees. Okay, well, there is we are at an interesting time, and this is probably something we should focus on, because this is something very in flux and happening in the moment right now. So a legal challenge to the existing minimum wage changes that happened last year. A quick summary, a ballot proposal was put forward last year to increase the minimum wage to $12, to eliminate the tip credit. For those of you who don't know what that is a separate and lower wage for tipped employees as long as the tips that they earn make them at least the minimum wage. The reality is most, if not all, servers are making substantially more than the minimum wage. $17 is a statewide average, well above $20 at plenty locations in the state. So the elimination of the tip credit, a major threat to this industry, was put forward last year. It was interesting to see the servers, the workers in the industry, rise up against this. So it was not your typical ownership versus labor type of an argument, which minimum wage sometimes gets purported to be. The tip credit is a unique scenario. It's a unique situation where the servers believe it works much better for them than the alternative. Ownership thrives and needs that differential, that tip credit, to frankly make it work. This is a 3 to 5% margin industry, which is why you see such a challenge to keep your doors open in this industry, even in good times. The legislature chose, with this and with also a paid sick leave mandate ballot proposal last year, to adopt them, which means to take them off the ballot, choosing to make them law. That happened in September of last year. And then in December, they came back and amended those proposals to restore a tip credit, restore a separate wage for tipped employees in the state, which we consider to be a big win for the workers and the owners in this industry, and spread out an increase. The increase to minimum wage still went to $12, but spread out over a longer time period, giving business owners a little more certainty, a little more time to adjust to the gradual increases in the minimum wage. And similar changes were made in the paid sick leave, spreading out some of the requirements and making them a little more tenable to the business community overall. So that happened in December. It was controversial. We started to move on, and then a challenge was posed last week by a state senator out of Detroit asking the Attorney General, was it legal? Is what the legislature did last year by adopting a ballot proposal, in other words, making that law, but then amending it in that same session. Is that okay? Is that constitutional? And it's a question that hasn't really been asked before, so it is interesting. Just yesterday, the legislature asked the Supreme Court to get involved. They want them to give a ruling to engage quickly. So there's some certainty for business owners. These changes to the minimum wage that passed in December are supposed to take effect in March, late March of this year, so just over a month from now. Business owners that we are hearing, not just in our industry, but across the state, uncertain of what to be doing, what to be prepared for a month from now. Asking the Supreme Court to weigh in is where this issue is likely going to end up anyways, and getting some certainty sooner. However the outcome, obviously we would like to retain a tip credit for the restaurant industry. Our business owners need certainty, and so we are hopeful that the Supreme Court weighs in. I put this entire explanation out to you because this is an existential threat as it relates to this industry, and everything else I talk about right now would be secondary to the effect of what comes out of the Supreme Court choosing to rule or not rule on this issue, because the tip credit is that critical, that essential to our industry. 1 minute. Okay, I have 1 minute. We're going to move on very quickly. Other trends to watch. So keep an eye on that. That is likely coming in the next month. Legalized marijuana. That's a big thing. We don't have time to talk about that right now. We talked about third-party delivery transforming the industry. More takeout, less people in restaurants. That's a problem. Restaurateurs are adjusting. You guys are well-positioned here in Battle Creek. I like the initiatives. I like the creation of space that you're trying to produce by recreating a downtown. That is what is driving traffic right now, independent restaurants that have something unique to offer, not particularly a chain restaurant. That's where you're seeing takeout increase and not creating as much traffic in restaurant. Slower growth for the lodging industry. Revenue that you can get per room going up, but pretty much on pace with increasing costs. This is the lodging industry, by the way. I'm going very fast. And Michigan, by the way, is lagging nationally. Our occupancy rate is down, but that 61.5% rate is up from where it was a couple years ago. You are seeing growth in Michigan, even if we're behind a national trend of occupancy rate in hotels. The average daily rate is behind, but that also eclipsed $100 very recently. That's a good thing for this state. Again, a little behind the national average, but growing, and the trend is in the right way. And 62 net new properties on the lodging front last year. That's a positive sign. That's a good thing. Trends to watch. Pure Michigan funding is essential. We have a new governor. Hopefully she believes in Pure Michigan, because the $9 to $1 of investment return is important for tourism across this state. I'm sure your CVB would agree. Short-term rentals are a problem. They don't pay taxes into your CVB, and they are making a concern within the industry in terms of safety and also in terms of not participating to the same degree that your lodging and hotels are. Post-Labor Day school start, we'll talk about that later. McCamley transition to DoubleTree. This is a big deal. DoubleTree is the fastest growing brand Hilton has. The reviews are very high. That creates a destination of downtown for people that otherwise might not have considered it to be. And the rewards driven customers also will drive some traffic downtown as well. That's a good sign. And who doesn't love the cookies? Everyone loves the DoubleTree cookies. They're coming here. That is how I'm going to conclude my presentation today. Thank you very much for the time.
Good morning. All right, so the reality for most of us is that we've thought about owning a business, and the truth is that for most of us, we should never even try. Our estimates are about one out of every 10 people really have the attitude and aptitude to own a business. And so the challenge is, as you think about your community, how do you get to the top entrepreneurial potential that you have in your community, which is, if you have 1,000 adults, how do you support the 100 who really have the attitude and aptitude? And the 100 will not always possess the ability to go to a bank and get a loan or necessarily have a rich uncle. So that's the space in which Northern Initiatives tries to work, is to try to engage as many people as we possibly can who have the attitude and the aptitude but will not be able to go to a bank, because banks don't do loans that they shouldn't do, can't do, or in many cases won't do. So that's our space, is to help people who we look at all the same information that a bank looks at, credit score, collateral, equity, but we focus more often on character and capacity. And those are the things that enable us to try to help support small businesses in local environments. We were started in 1992 at Northern Michigan University, where the university was concerned about the boom and bust cycles that come from mining and the timber industries, and wanted to see a building of a more diverse and resilient economy. So that became our focus, was to focus on small businesses. We started lending money in 1994. Our typical loan is anywhere from $10,000 to $500,000. The smallest loan we've ever done is $1,000, the largest $1.6 million. And we're now working in 73 of the 83 counties in Michigan and 5 border counties of Wisconsin. And we have place-based initiatives here in Battle Creek, Muskegon, and Marquette. So the Battle Creek Loan Fund has the potential to get to $13.5 million. The Kellogg Foundation has set up a match program so that contributions are doubled. So over the next several years, we've got a lot of money to work with. And thanks to the contributions of Battle Creek Unlimited, Consumers Energy, the Kellogg Corporation, the Miller Foundation, and John Banks and Mayor Mark Binky, who have all contributed to the fund. So the performance for last year, we closed 8 loans, and those 8 loans have, there's now been a 9th added, so we're over $1 million in loans that we've made, which is the fastest that we've ever gotten to that kind of lending in any one place in the 25 years that we've been working. So it's very exciting to see what we're looking at. We've replaced the approved pending close with another loan for $300,000. So we now have 3 in underwriting, and we have lots of prospects. And the issues that we're going to face in terms of the prospects are getting to the point where they've got business plans to where we can really perform underwriting. And so those steps, we're taking some steps internally to try to support more people to be able to develop their own business plan. So Kelly Hoffman and Israel Flores are here, and they're the ones that are making this happen. So for 2019, the long game is we want to do more business development. And business development means that we want to take people who have an initial idea and try to support them to be able to grow that idea into something that can become viable. So we're really trying to spend a lot of time working with John and Valerie and others, trying to look at who's doing interesting things in their kitchen, or showing up at the farmer's market, or having the potential that they may be able to grow something into something bigger. When we look at our portfolio, we're about 25% restaurants currently, which is a little higher than we'd like to be, 25% manufacturing, about 20% hospitality and tourism, another 20% in services, and 10% in spirits. So we have a pretty diverse portfolio, all family-owned businesses. The manufacturing tends to be taking subordinated debt, and 30% of our overall lending tends to be focused on startups. So the business development aspect is trying to bring more people who show that attitude and aptitude into a place where they can start a business. We also are looking to try to create a support fund for our borrowers. So as has been mentioned many times, the challenges that everyone is facing is keeping their workers and being able to have a stable workforce. So the idea is that what we'll do is help support a loan fund that will help families in emergencies. So car breaks down, they lose their daycare, they're in a situation where they need to move away from a spouse or other things. So we'll have this emergency loan fund that we'll create. We'll work with local financial institutions, but it becomes a way that we can support our portfolio and its workers to be able to be stable. We also are trying to do more in knowledge building services. So we've created a portal for our customers, and it has 21 videos, 100 reading resources, 6 financial calculators. All of those things are intended to help build the knowledge base of our workers. So going back to our hypothetical, if we had 1,000 people and 100 have the attitude and aptitude, we would also expect that something like 10 are going to be responsible for 80% of the jobs and 80% of the innovation. So the difference between whether someone is going to be small or whether they're going to grow is a question of can they build systems. So we try to focus on ways to support our customers in the knowledge side of the business to be able to grow their business by building systems. This year we're going to be doing more work to translate our portal into Spanish so that it becomes accessible to more people, and we'll start to look at other languages as we go down the road. So the challenge is not only can we bring small businesses into the marketplace, but then how will the marketplace accept those small businesses? So supporting local businesses is huge. And in Marquette, for example, my wife always shops at Christmas time for me at Goetz's department store in downtown Marquette. And the great thing about Goetz's is they know me and they know who I am. So we avoid a lot of returns by the fact that my wife can say, "How do you think this would look on Dennis?" And the store people knowing who in fact Dennis is. So local businesses know, if I go to the Barista Blues Cafe, they are making my order as I walk through the door. It's that knowing and understanding and feeling supported in your community, I think that's really important, and that's a big part of what local is. So I think the challenge is for all of us to consider, how do we increase our local spending? I try in Marquette to be about 80% supporting local, because not only that's because it's important to what we do, but it's important to support these local businesses because they're the ones that are doing really important things. They tend to pay higher hourly wages. They tend to hold on to their employees longer. And they're really the salt of your community. They're the differentiators. We've heard Kitchen Prosper named a few times today. That is a differentiator for your community. When people from the outside come in and say, this is the best meal I've ever had. Those small businesses are so important and so huge for the future of Battle Creek, and we can bring them to you. And as Peter Drucker said, culture trumps strategy. So culture has to evolve in all places to continue to think about what you can do in order to support these small businesses, because those are the things that make this community unique and will continue to help this community thrive. Thank you.
Good morning. My name is Earl Pileski. It's my privilege to be the director of the Michigan State Housing Development Authority. And I'm a CPA by profession, but it was my privilege to work with Dr. Bizon in the House of Representatives a few years ago. Pleasure to meet Representative Hadsmith this morning. And we look forward to working with our friends in the legislature and in state government and here to make more housing for folks. Our mission at MHDA, the State Housing Development Authority, is to partner to provide homes and preserve places for the people of Michigan. When we talk about our partners, we're talking about local government. We're talking pretty much about anyone who is in this room. Not-for-profits, we work with for-profit developers, we work with foundations, we work with loan originators, banks, credit unions, mortgage companies, and the like. We don't do really anything by ourselves. We do it in partnership with others, and we look forward to doing it in partnership with you. We fulfill that mission by supporting home ownership. We do single family mortgage lending through our mortgage originators. We don't have any storefronts ourselves, but we work with banks, credit unions, mortgage companies to originate loans for folks who need homes. We preserve history. The State Historic Preservation Office is part of MHDA. So if you have historic issues, we also work with that. We also provide affordable rental housing through our multifamily development program. We are the allocator of the low-income housing tax credit here in Michigan. That's a federal tax credit for low-income housing development. We allocate about $26 million per year of that credit to try and get affordable housing built. Asset management is the process of making sure that what has been built remains sustainable. And so we monitor compliance with the low-income housing tax credit to make sure that those developments, once they are in place, stay sustainable and stay working for the folks that they're intended to work for. And one of our missions also is ending homelessness. We're going to talk a little bit about housing this morning on a statewide basis, and then more specifically to Battle Creek and what things we can do with you at MHDA. We do expect to see continued growth in housing here in Michigan. The state's total household growth will likely exceed 4 million by 2020. We are seeing a continued pressure for housing. As you've heard from all the speakers this morning, the economy is growing, employment is growing, that creates demand for housing. And friends, housing is where jobs go to sleep at night. If you haven't housing, all the economic development in the world will not grow your economy beyond a certain point. For example, down in Coldwater, the Clemens plant is there. There's a huge demand for housing there. We are working with the city of Coldwater. But frankly, Clemens is very much concerned to make sure that there is housing nearby for their employees in Coldwater. We're also seeing, renters' incomes are lower than average, as you might expect. Affordability for renters is a significant issue. Many are paying more than 30% of their income towards sheltering costs. So this is an ongoing problem, and we are working to attempt to address it. Here in Battle Creek, as you probably know, housing is reasonably priced, but not always available for those who may need it. Even those without mortgages in Battle Creek are considered to be over, 15% of owners are overburdened, 5% severely so. In other words, they're paying more than 50% of their income toward housing costs in that case. Just to give you a little bit of information there about single family mortgages we have written in Battle Creek over the past 5 years. And most of our borrowers, tuck this away for future use, most of our borrowers do take advantage of our down payment assistance plan. That is a process whereby we will lend, note it's lend, not grant, will lend up to $7,500 of down payment assistance for those who had the capability to pay on a mortgage, but who have not been able to gather together the down payment they may need. So down payment assistance sits as a silent second mortgage. It does not bear interest and it does not require payments. Only when the property is sold or refinanced would that loan come due. So we can get folks into houses who have the capability to pay but who do not have the down payment assistance yet. And we do that in over 90% of our mortgage loans here in Michigan. So here in Battle Creek, I think it's not surprising to say that there are folks who are overburdened, who are renters here in Battle Creek, just as there are around the rest of the state. Over 90% of the vacant for rent units are priced between $200 and $800, but frankly, some income levels will not afford even that. Again, here in Battle Creek, 52% of renters are overburdened, 27% severely so. So some suggestions to deal with housing here in Battle Creek, just as we would suggest anywhere else in the state. Consider your local funding sources. You do have some and many excellent resources here in Battle Creek. Consider working with our friends within the Talent and Economic Development Department, those friends being the Michigan Economic Development Corporation and the Michigan Land Bank, along with MISHTA, to arrive at some ideas on how to skin the cat to provide some excellent housing here. I would suggest also to those of our friends in local government to make sure that your processes of zoning approval and any other permitting processes are efficient and predictable. People will invest where they see that they can make an investment and make a profit from it. Profit is not a bad word at MISHTA. You have to be able to make a profit to build some housing. But friends in the local units of government, if you can make it easy and predictable for someone to invest in your area, they're more likely to do that than somewhere else where they are uncertain. You're going to have another little benefit here in Battle Creek. There is a young lady going to go to work for the Kellogg Foundation by the name of Jamie Schreiner. She is currently the executive director of the of CEDAM, Economic Development Association of Michigan, and she is a fireball. We enjoy working with Jamie at CEDAM, and we look forward to working with her here in Battle Creek. We're always looking at what we can do better. Grand Rapids recently needed a grocery store in a particular area. The Meyer store had closed, and so housing was built, but on the first floor is a grocery store. It's Gordon's. Gordon's has a grocery store on Michigan Street in Grand Rapids. Now, you always think of Gordon's being, you know, the big jar of pickles, right? No, they also have a deli, they got a bakery, and frankly, some of the folks who live upstairs are working at the grocery store. There's a lot of good ideas, and we would look forward to working with you to make those work. I want to talk very briefly about opportunity zones. That was something that came along in tax reform in 2017. There are some opportunity zones here in Calhoun County. Basically, an opportunity zone is a place where if an investment is made by someone who has some capital gains to shelter, and it's a proper investment, that capital gain can be deferred and to some extent eliminated, and the income earned within the opportunity zone the gain within that opportunity zone not taxed. So we would simply offer this as another opportunity for opportunity in opportunity zones to make some investment. You see there, this is on our website too, by the way, michigan.gov/MISHTA. Here in Calhoun County, you see much of the city of Battle Creek. You see the city of Albion, and I believe over there is Marshall, are parts of opportunity zones. Let's see, the city of Albion and Albion Township, Eckford Township, Fredonia Township, Marengo Township, and the city of Marshall and Marshall Township. As I said before, we partner to provide homes and preserve places for the people of Michigan. We want to partner with you. If there are ideas or thoughts or just uncertainties, I've got some frankly brilliant people that work for us. They are very sharp. They're very sharp financial people, but they are also interested in achieving the social good of having people be in excellent homes. MISHTA is effectively a bank with a social mission, and we look forward to working with you. Thank you.
Okay, as we wrap up, before we get into questions and answers, let's give our panel a round of applause. These are great speakers. Just want to kind of wrap this up and talk about all of the great things we heard up here today. These things that are happening in Battle Creek aren't happening in a vacuum. They're happening with a lot of collaboration, both behind the scenes and in front of you all on a daily basis. So we wanted to throw together, and I apologize if I missed anybody, but these are all the entities and all the folks that are working collectively together on economic development here in Battle Creek and, frankly, Calhoun County. With that, we'll open it up for a few questions. Does anybody have any questions? We've got some speakers or microphones going around.
Jim, I want to talk tariffs. What's the outlook as far as the effect of the tariff increases that are prospective to go through here on the national, state economies, job growth, et cetera?
Interesting question. Not enough time to talk about it this morning in the presentation. We've looked at this. Certainly, if we look at Michigan, it's about a $60 billion export economy. The largest share, about $29 billion, is in transportation equipment, with the primary movements to Canada. When we look at machinery, fabricated metals, and other things, it's to Mexico. So a lot of that is covered under the USMCA. The U.S.-Mexico-Canada agreement. Our commodity chemicals, 25%, go to the EU, so that's still one that's in flux. Where we're probably, our biggest exposure is in the soybean area and in agriculture because of Chinese decisions to not buy American soybeans till we get that resolved. But under USMCA, moving of other animal products, meaning milk, into Canada has been opened up. So it's probably not a bad thing overall. I think if you've seen some numbers that, for instance, the impact of tariffs on Caterpillar, about $200 million, but that's on $3 billion of revenue. So how much a 10%, kind of going back to Joe's thing on beer, if you're buying a $10 four-pack of some great craft beer, how much is a 10% change going to impact the can? Certainly, it is one of those things, along with interest rates and ability to get labor and other things, that could provoke a recession if not resolved. But things sound fairly good, and some of this probably, again, coming from a nonpartisan organization, probably really needed to be realigned.
So in closing, as you can see, there are many great things happening in our community, and they're not by accident. They're not happening in a vacuum, as I mentioned earlier. There's a ton of coordination and collaboration taking place behind the scenes from many dedicated individuals, from many arrays of organizations within our community. That doesn't mean we don't have our share of problems to work together on in this community, or we won't encounter future struggles together. This just means we must address them together to create a Battle Creek that we all want and know is possible. We've heard from an array of experts today that the potential to make real change is here, and it's up to us to not watch the opportunity pass us by, but make possibilities a reality. We must continue our work, we must ramp up our efforts, we must collaborate like never before. Now is the time. Great things are happening today in Battle Creek. Let's keep the momentum going, and thank you all for attending today.
Your community.